images. What is the size of the image? Your answer would be this. You could find, sit over saw it, and then just what we did here, multiply it by 1.14. There it is. Okay. The other thing I may ask you, what is the percentage of magnification? And guess what?
14%.
It's 14%. Whatever's after the one is what it is. So again, you could take 8 inches, multiply it by 14%, and you're going to get 9.12. So if you just want to know sit over sod or image over object, it depends what's given to you up here. Sit over sod, image over object, you can find the others. So we can make it very simple. We don't have to memorize all those different formulas. Are we good with that? We'll find out when we do your feet. And I don't know, I like drawing my little picture just to make sure that I don't get confused of what I'm talking about. So I tend to be a little bit more visual. So if you want to do that, so you don't make mistakes. Like I said, usually the only place you make a mistake is on that side. So be careful. Magnification, another type is that's size distortion. So as we were talking about, decreasing magnification means increasing the SID will decrease your magnification. So this is the one that, as a beginner, for me anyway, that took me a little while to understand. The further away the x-ray tube is from the patient, the less magnification. And we know with OID, if we want to decrease magnification, what do we have to do to the OID?
Decrease it.
Decrease it. So we want the body part as close to the patient, the patient as close to the image receptor as possible. There are times that we can't do that. A lateral C-spine. Okay, so the patient on a lateral C-spine, you haven't studied that yet, but C1 goes up to the level of the EAM, C7 goes through the shoulders, and you want to be able to see T1 to make sure you can see all of the space below C7, right? C1 through C7. And so the image receptor, the bottom of it has to come about right here, below the level of the shoulder. And so what happens is you've got that gap between the neck and your image receptor. And what can you do? I mean, it's not like you can like get the shoulder up underneath the image receptor and get the patient's neck to it. It's impossible. So, you've got that increased OID because of the body part. So what can you do?
Increase SID.
Increase the SID to compensate for that. And guess what distance we use for our lateral C-spines?
72.
And it's for that reason. So if you're in a situation where typically it's not in your room because you have a lot of control over that, but it's when you're in a different environment, you're up doing a portable or maybe in surgery, and you have that increased OID that for whatever reason can't be put close together in surgery, you may not be able to get your cassette right up to the body part because of instruments and things and sterile fields. And so you don't have to think, okay, it's going to be a poor image quality because you can increase your SID. So these are the kind of things you have to think about on your feet as you're, making all your x-rays. Do you need to position properly? Yes, but you also need to have a good image quality, and there's, again, many things to think about in trying to get that. As you get out into the hospital and you work with that all the time, it comes more and more natural to you. Okay, so this is the situation that we want to have. So again, and I'm going to ask you these kind of relationship questions. So, when you're going through these questions, slow down a little bit. Increase SID, what happens to radiographic quality? This is just the opposite of what I asked you a minute ago. I said increase SID decreases magnification. increase SID, increases radiographic quality. So if you understand the concept, these are really easy to answer. But again, this one is always the little trickier one, I think, as students. And we haven't studied chest x-rays yet, but we do 72 inches for a chest x-ray. Do you know why? Why we use the long distance for a chest? I mean, we get the patient right up next to the wall, you know, Becky, the wall unit. It's because of the heart. We want the heart as true to size as possible, and you will have that on your test in positioning, so you can thank me later. The heart, when doctors look at the chest, they're not just looking at the lungs and making sure there's, you know, nothing wrong with the lungs, but they also look at the lungs, the heart size, and they can maybe predict, they can diagnose COPD, cardiomegaly, and that sort of thing. So you can really tell the difference between a portable chest x-ray at, you know, a shorter distance and one at 72 inches. And so we want to get as much distance as we can reasonably. We're not going to back up 5 feet to get that x-ray, and you have to, you know, or 10 feet or whatever, because what happens as you increase your distance? What do you have to do to your exposure factors?
Bump it up.
Yes, increase it. Direct square loss. See what I'm talking about? So there's a compromise there. You want an increased distance and get the heart to true size, but then you don't want so much distance that you're going to have to give the patient more radiation. So everything's kind of a compromise and within reason. So that's why we do chest x-rays at 72 inches. So there will be a reason for some of this. Everybody, you may go to your hospital. I think we're pretty classic, but your technical factors are typically set at a 40-inch SID. But you'll go to hospitals, and they may use 44 inches as their standard instead of 40 inches. Mammograms, if you go into mammography, their standard SID is 36 inches. So 40 is give or take. So not everyone uses an exact 40. You're not married to that. You can change whatever distance you want to use. You want to use 39? Go for it. It's okay. What happens though, once you start changing your distance, if all the technical factors that you have are at a 40-inch SID and you want to use 44, then you're going to have to adjust your technical factors to compensate for that. That's all that is. And then, of course, as the OID increases, what happens to radiographic quality? Decreases. Okay, shape distortion. This is the misrepresentation of the shape of the object. And so there are several things that can affect this. The object thickness or the shape of the object can lead to shape distortion. The thicker the body part is, the more distortion you're going to have. And what about radiographic quality? Hello?
Go down.
Decrease. Right. You are there, right? Is that this mean here? Okay. So, again, you don't have a lot of choice with this. Your patient is the size and shape that they are. So you will have very little control over this one. Now, the position of the patient, you do have control over. Typically you have, maybe unless a trauma situation or a surgery situation. But how we position the object to the x-ray tube and to the image receptor is going to affect our shape distortion. So typically, in what you've been doing is you have the x-ray tube above, then the patient nice and flat, then your image receptor. And we have all those things lined up. Well, there will be times that we don't want that. When they're all lined up, we get minimal shape distortion. That's the minimal shape distortion. When we start to move any one of these three factors right here, we're going to get elongation or foreshortening depending on how we move that. Regardless, if we have elongation or foreshortening, that is shape distortion, and we will have a decrease in radiographic quality. There are times, and lots of times, and I can give you a lot of examples of when we do this all the time. And it's not to reduce radiographic quality is to see body parts that are obscured due to superimposition of other body parts. Here are some examples. You have the x-ray tube over, a femur. What is that? A humerus? I don't know. Bone. This is bone. It doesn't matter. Dog's bone. Dog's chew toy. Okay, so here's the x-ray tube over the bone. And okay, notice that there is magnification. We do have a little increased OID. We can get rid of that by bringing this tube up more. But anyway, nice and flat, same shape. Not same size, but same shape. Okay, so here we can angle the body part and get a distortion of the image. It's going to, in this particular case, be what? Foreshortened or elongated?
Elongation.
This is going to be foreshortened. It's going to look actually smaller. We'll look at some more examples. And then here, you could also move the image receptor. So notice the x-ray tube is up above. The bone is flat, parallel to that, and then the image receptor is angled. So that would be elongation. And one thing that is not shown up here, maybe it's on this one, the x-ray tube can actually be moved. So here, it's not doing that, but we could have the bone flat and the x-ray tube angle across, and that will give elongation. So any one of those three movement, the x-ray tube being angled, the body part being angled, or the image receptor being angled will give us either elongation or foreshortening. Not a problem when you're using the image receptor underneath the table. The image receptor is going to be flat, and so that won't be angled. But you have to think about it. When you're doing those decubitus or you're going across the table for whatever reason, that image, we have a cassette holder to hold the image receptor to the side of the table, and it should hold it straight up and down. I never used one of those growing up. When I was your age, guess what I used? Because you would have to go get it. You'd have to walk from here to the shelf and get it and bring it back. I could have had the x-ray done by then. You just wait. You'll be the same way. And so I just had the patient hold it. You know, if they're laying there, I put it up next to their back and just had them hold it. Not necessarily a good idea, because what can happen?
They can move
it. Yeah, or they... We'll play this together, and I'll have you hold it. And sometimes you have to make sure the patient's doing what you've asked them to do, and they're holding it straight, because if it leans away, it's going to cause some distortion. So so sometimes that happens. You're doing a portable, and you don't have the cassette stand to hold it nice and straight. You have to be careful with that. Sometimes we want distortion. Sometimes we want that. You haven't studied skull yet, but here's a PA skull. You're looking at the frontal bone right here, and what's behind that? When you're looking at a skull straight on, what you can't see or don't see very much of is the occipital bone. And so how do you get an image of the occipital bone? Well, turn them over. Well, it's still going to look the same. They're superimposed on each other one way or the other. So when we want to see the occipital bone by itself, look at this angle. We angle the x-ray tube 30 degrees, and what happens is that throws the frontal bone down and leaves the occipital bone. So we do, 30 degrees is a lot of angle. The most we've do with angles is a 45 degree, and that is a huge angle. 30 is a pretty good angle, 30, 35 degrees. So you get this very distorted image, but that's, so yes, do we lose some radiographic quality? Yes. However, we need to see the occipital bone. Is it blurry? Is it poor? No. Image quality is still okay for a diagnosis, but that's just an example. You see the orbits right here, and see how they're filled up? That's the Petrus pyramids. That's where the inner ear is housed. And it's a very dense portion of the skull. And you'll learn this next semester. And when you do a PA skull, those Petrus ridges should fill up the orbits. So here are the Petrus ridges right here. So you can kind of tell about the distortion, how, you know, instead of being parallel like here, they're angled. But again, we're seeing all. And that's that, you know what that is? That's a frame and magnum, the base of the skull. So we are looking literally at all the occipital bone. And so that's Okay, so my question is elongation or foreshortening?
Elongation.
Elongation, correct. Here's one that you've done, a hand x-ray. Here's your PA hand, no distortion, it's flat. And then you do an oblique, 45 degree oblique. Is that going to be foreshortening or elongation?
Foreshortening.
Foreshortening. See how it looks thinner compared to the PA? So it's foreshortened. So in that case, the x-ray tube and the image receptor were parallel to each other and the body part was angled. And that typically gives you foreshortening.
That's it.
When you angle the x-ray tube or the image receptor, that typically gives you elongation. We're not through with class yet, so don't get excited. But what I have for you, I have some review questions. This is where I want to stop. Do we have a